evening, ladies and gentlemen. May I have your attention? Good evening and welcome. On behalf of the African Development Bank, I'd like to warmly welcome you to this high-level debate. The theme today is very simple. Is this Africa's hour? Now, that seems like a very extraordinary question to ask, especially at the annual gathering of the ADB. I mean, if this was not Africa's hour, thousands of you wouldn't have flown from all over the world to actually be here. But my role this evening is to ask the more critical questions. If this is Africa's hour, what was happening for the last 23? If this is Africa's hour, what does it mean for the ordinary men and women who are not attending conferences like this? If this is Africa's hour, whose agenda is being served? That's my role. Your role is to be quiet observers for a period of time and to join me now first in welcoming an excellent, an incredible panel. And I congratulate the AFDB for putting together this team. For me, as a journalist, this is where I truly enjoy myself. I've had the pleasure of interviewing each and every one of them, and they all come to this platform with a different background, with different experiences, but all with a passion for this continent. So without further ado, let's begin. I'd first like to welcome what I would say is perhaps the, without a doubt, the most senior person on our panel. He's the head of state. For many years, he has worked tirelessly to transform his nation. And even his critics will agree that what has happened in his country is extraordinary. Ladies and gentlemen, join me in welcoming His Excellency, the President of Rwanda, Paul Kagame. Good to see you again, Mr. President.
Thank you. I think your seat is this one.
Oh, this one. I know this isn't an opportunity to share personal stories and experiences, but I must add that one of the most important things about His Excellency the President, I think one thing that millions of people around the world admire and respect him for, is the fact that he supports Arsenal Football Club, Mr. President. I like him for that. This is going to be a pretty easy and free-flowing conversation. The next gentleman I'd like to invite to the stage is actually our kind host. Again, a man I've interviewed many times before and has led, in many regards, the transformation, not just of the institution that he heads, but has played a vital role in the economic and infrastructural transformation of our continent. Mr. Donald Kabaruka, you're welcome. Now, in case you're wondering, I'm not here in the capacity of the BBC. I'm here as Komla Dumor because a few weeks ago, Donald Kabaruka picked up the phone and said, Komla, I need you to do something. And I'm sure as staff of you here at the AFDB know, nobody says no to Donald. So I'm here and pleased to be so. Thank you very much, Donald. I would now like to welcome the finance minister of Africa's biggest economy. Again, a man who I've had the pleasure of speaking to many times, soft-spoken, but incredibly hard-working and passionate about transformation, not just in his country, but across the continent as well. And you learn something new every day. His background as finance minister is not the typical one. He's not your economist or your classically trained, you know, financial person. His background is in pharmacy, so perhaps he has the antidotes, the way to treat the problems of the continent with a different perspective. Join me in welcoming Pravin Gordhan. What can we possibly say about Mo Ibrahim? He's Mo Ibrahim.
That's right.
Does he need an introduction? But we'll give him one anyway. There are many successful people across the continent, but very few have devoted their time and resources to encouraging and supporting the democratic transformation of our continent. Unlike others, he's put his money where his mouth is, and he always has something to say when it comes to issues of democracy and transforming this continent. Mr. Mo Ibrahim, you're welcome. Let's give him a round of applause. Now, a quick note before we get going. I'm sure you've already noticed that this is a very gender imbalanced panel. Am I right? Well, let me make something clear. We did invite the Finance Minister of Nigeria, the very well-respected Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala, but because of travel arrangements, and that's the only reason she's been unable to join us. But for someone who has worked incredibly hard, not just in her own country, but represented the continent at the highest levels of international economics, even though she's absent, let's give her a round of applause anyway. Right, now, ladies and gentlemen, let's get to work. Dr. Kaburuka, I think I'll start with you because you are the host of this event that's brought us all together. Is this Africa's hour? And when that question is asked, I wonder what evidence you see from where you sit as head of the AFDB that suggests that we are at a point in the continent, at a point of transformation unprecedented, that is going to move this continent forward unlike any other period in the past.
Thank you, Kumla. First of all, can I thank you and our guests to this annual meeting of the bank, beginning with my president here, for honoring us with your presence. My colleagues and I are very pleased that you could be here. Now, something extraordinary is happening in the continent of Africa. I said yesterday morning that the GDP of this continent has multiplied 4.5 times in 10 years. If you adjust for inflation, it has doubled. It has never happened in history except in China, Malaysia, and India. Now, I also said that the British, it took them 150 years. So that is a fact, it is a number. You could say the same for real per capita incomes. Now, do we still have huge pockets of problem? Of course we do. Do we still have many challenges to overcome? Of course we do. From infrastructure to skills to human development issues. But I think the big issue for me, why I see it as head of the bank, is that we now have to figure out how to make this thing sustainable, how to make it inclusive, so that the African people see the advantages. We want to make sure it is not volatile, it does not disappear. So that is our task. So the hour is ours, but now we have to work to ensure that it is sustained over many years.
President Kagame, you are one of the, I would say, the rare Twitter-savvy heads of state around the world. And when I posted online that we were having this conversation, we got quite a few tweets, including one which was asked by, in fact, by a colleague who said, it was Africa's hour 5 years ago. It was Africa's hour 10 years ago. To even ask the question that, is it Africa's hour again, means certain issues have not been resolved. Do you share Donald Kaburuka's optimism, or do you think that this euphoria over, is it Africa's hour, Africa on the rise, the African lion, needs to be tempered with some serious thought?
I fully agree with the one who tweeted, in a sense, but also bring on board Dr. Kaburuka's views. And I am asking myself, when was it not Africa's hour? It always has been. And in fact, we've seen economic booms in the past that have come to pass and left us with nothing. But there is also good ground on which to believe with optimism that Africa can make it to where we want to be. And for two reasons. Look at the material and human resources of Africa. In them, there is a story we can write We just got to do things right. But also, secondly, look at comparable countries or regions that have worked their way out of poverty to middle income to the first world category. And you always ask yourself, what is it with Africa that we cannot do the same or even do better? So everything is there for us to be able to move in the direction we have to and attain the levels of development we desire to have. And there are certain things we simply must do and be able to make that consistent and sustainable. So there are still challenges, but there are huge opportunities, and it's up to us to be able to tap into these opportunities, deal with the challenges, and move forward.
I'll return to that theme in a moment, but I want to, ask you, Mo Ibrahim, when you hear President Kagame say, we can, there are things that we can do, the opportunity is right. The question I'll then put to you from someone who is closely watching the big picture is, will we as opposed to can we?
I wish I could say we will, because we have some serious challenges. What makes me optimistic, actually, is the rise of the civil society in Africa, which is really a new phenomenon, and that underpins a lot of the changes going to Africa. Young people in Africa. Africa, half the people of Africa are below 19 years old. Those are a continent of young people. And those young people are really different from our generation. They are better educated, and they are better connected with each other, and they are not afraid. And they have no much respect for us, actually. We have to admit that.
Why is that a good thing?
I think that's good because we really need to challenge. And it's not business as usual anymore. Africa changes, and those wonderful young people coming forward now are growing in a different environment. And the questions they ask is not just where is my food, where is my job? The questions they ask, why those kids like me in America or in China or in have this wonderful life. Why I'm having this when I'm walking, you know, on this rich land? Africa is a rich continent, but Africans are poor. And there's no justification for that. So we need people to come and challenge this business as usual. This new generation coming up very aggressively, and rightly so, the rise of the civil society around them, all that really underpin the transformation of Africa. We have more democratically elected presidents in Africa now than any time before. The majority of African presidents now are really democratically elected. And that's a major change also on the landscape in Africa. So this political and socioeconomic developments in Africa give me hope but there is challenges, and that's why I'm reluctant to say we will do it. The challenges, for example, we have economic development, as Donald have mentioned, over the last decade, a wonderful development. But this development, did it trickle through to the people? That's the question. If the fruits of development is only locked in the top 1 or 2% of the population, then this is not development. This is not sustainable. And that will lead to tension in the fabric of the society, and that will not help in the long term. So we need to have sustainable development. And we need to watch for this issue of the quality. The agenda of integration in Africa is not moving forward. Mm-hmm. And you know, and everybody here know, everybody there know, that without really economic integration, mm-hmm. we're not going to go anywhere. Yes, we can do a little bit of things in our country here, on his country, on that country. But if Africa need to stand up and compete with China, with Europe, with America, with India, with Brazil, we need to break our borders. Mm. We really need to have this larger community, because that is the way forward. That's why I have, these question marks.
Yeah, we're going to raise that issue. And it's fortunate that we have President Kagame on this panel, because Rwanda has taken that extraordinary step of actually opening up its borders for all Africans, as a matter of fact. You know, the visa process has been simplified. Well, we'll come to that in a moment. But I still want to stay with the theme that you raised about Africa's young people.
Yeah.
And I don't think there's any disagreement, Pravin Gordhan, that is the driving force of the continent. South Africa presents an extraordinary example. It is the continent's biggest economy. But you also, in some ways, represent many of the challenges the continent has. Many young people coming out of school, looking for work. Look at the case of South Africa, and then perhaps if you could try to broaden it to the rest of the continent. And the question I ask you is this phenomenal growth that we speak of, if it is phenomenal in the first place, creating enough employment, and realizing the expectations of young people to the extent that when we hit 2050 and we're 2.5 billion Africans, there'll still be an Africa left?
No, they will. And I think the word "our" is a metaphorical one. It's basically saying that Africa's history has taken it through many different eras or epochs. And you asked earlier on, what happened to the other 23 hours? They're still to come. So this is the first hour of the new epoch, if you want to put it that way. Mm-hmm. And if one links that to the point that President Kagame makes, which is that we have, let's start with Donald. We've created a very useful foundation. Mm-hmm. We have levels of growth. We have a greater recognition of the potential in the continent, more aware of the resources that we have. And the world is becoming more aware of us and less cynical about us as well. Not by choice, but because they're forced to. Because they recognize that they, in different parts of the world, are running into different types of cul-de-sacs, which ultimately means they have to come to Africa either this year or 10 years from now. But they have to come here and connect with Africa in some way. If you take President Kagame's point, then we're saying the opportunities are there for us to craft a very different kind of future for this continent and perhaps for humanity as well. Because the huge privilege we have as Africans, and certainly as South Africa, is to recognize on the one hand what our weaknesses are, recognize the successes elsewhere in the world, but also recognize the limitations of the current social and developmental models that you see elsewhere in the world. And so Mr. Ibrahim would be a little bit more hesitant about saying we will. I think we need to be positive. The opportunities are there. We need to say, as we would say in South Africa, let's give it our best shot and try to overcome those challenges that are correctly identified. One can't deny them. And mobilize both the young people and others within our societies to start believing in themselves. The challenge for us is that the international discourse is still dominated by, let's call it, Western media. And I think many in the Western media actually see Africa as a potential challenge 10, 15 years from now. Mm-hmm. So start shooting it down now. Mm-hmm. And the challenge for all of us is to start a narrative which says we can develop different options and better options than the world has been able to provide until now. We can develop options that will indeed give hope to young people, but also create models that don't result in the same inequality that we see elsewhere in the world. But it does mean that we need to challenge ourselves as well in ensuring that we don't just mimic other people's models. But make more conscious efforts at creating models that reduce inequality and don't repeat inequality. Recognize that technology is very useful, but I think the West is also beginning to realize that technology, particularly over-mechanization of economies means less jobs. Mm. So we need to find some different answer, not the kind of answer that developed economies have actually found. And at the end of the day, challenges mean there's work to do, and work for us to do together. And if we can successfully put aside our individual differences as countries and as different levels of leaders, I think we have a huge success story ahead of us.
Okay, so Minister Gordhan, you've actually walked into my next question, which then I'll throw back to you, is if we need to work together, if we need to be better integrated, why do I need a visa to go to South Africa?
Because we have immigration laws. And that, despite the fact that you need a visa, there's lots of people there who didn't get a visa and are there. And so today, South Africa is in fact a magnet for people from all parts of Africa. Mm-hmm. It's probably many parts of South Africa are more cosmopolitan than any other part of Africa. And
not to put you on the spot, but I find it extraordinary that you know, we've been having this conversation online, and of course this is, it's just an open conversation. But I do find that many people agree with me when I suggest that it is actually easier to travel through Africa holding a European passport, yes, than it is with an African passport. Mr. Ibrahim, I don't think there's...
Which is something we need to work on. Something that we need to work on.
But President Kagame has worked on it, and he got it done. January 1st, I suppose I can arrive in Kigali. And what was the thinking behind that, President Kagame?
The thinking was manifold. One, it is to demonstrate that it is possible, and it carries no dangers to anyone who does it. Meaning a country that opens up its borders for the fellow Africans. The second goes along with the idea that was emphasized for good reason, and that is important, by Mo Ibrahim, about integration. Integration is key. And we are seeing it develop in the East African region. We have the East African Community, 5 countries, 135 million people. And we are beginning to make progress on the customs union, on the common market. We are discussing the common currency and moving possibly in the near future, who knows, political federation. But we are making sure that we do it right, and we are getting lessons from where things have been done and they haven't worked out. For example, if anything is to be learned from the Eurozone, then we will do that. So it was really the reason. Even as it serves us well, because we are having people coming to Rwanda, either as tourists or people who actually want to come there and set up shop and create employment, make investments of different kinds, and so on and so forth. This is to our benefit. And we've seen that happen. But emphasizing that whole issue of bringing Africa together in a practical way rather than just talking about it all the time.
So, Mr. President, when you are with your colleague heads of state at the African Union or any other forum, what are you saying to them to make this a reality? Because, you know, Rwanda presents a fairly extraordinary example, but there are still many countries that are actually not moving in that direction. Are you advocating for a borderless Africa?
Is there a better way of advocating for that than actually doing it? That's what we did.
Mo Ibrahim.
Can I ask my brother here, President Kagame, your experience after you opened this, has your country been swamped by undesirable Africans swamping your people?
Or you mean Nigerians and Ghanaians? I'm one myself, that's all right.
You watch out.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. It's an interesting question. We've seen more people come to Rwanda. We've seen Nigerians. We've seen Ghanaians. We've seen people from across the continent. And most of those who have been coming are as good as we would have expected. And if there is any wrong person coming in, the laws of the country and the systems of the country and the institutions will take care of that. Mm-hmm. So we have no problem with that.
Why can't we make that experience available to our friends? And I don't want to pick in South Africa, but most African countries, actually, mm-hmm. not South Africa. And we say, look, guys, this xenophobia, that everybody in Africa are worried about those other Africans swamping us. Everybody, and you say, exactly, where those guys come from Mars, from, you know, everybody's afraid from everybody else. Mm-hmm. And what we need is solid data to say, look, here is a country, open their borders, they have not been swamped, the criminality have not increased, and just open your, and what about all these Europeans who come to your countries without visas? Are they all wonderful, people? There's no criminals among them, there is no, let us start with small things to really, there's no point to meet any African in Paris or in London, and people, you know, say, oh, hi, brother, hello, brother, we are all brothers, we are all sisters. And but then in our, we come back to Africa, and we just lock everybody out. And it doesn't
Pravin Gordhan, you have the floor.
Yeah, no, I just want to, since they're picking on South Africa, you
We're
see.
Not picking on anyone.
So let me defend my country.
Yes,
South Africa probably has probably up to 5 million brothers and sisters from other parts of Africa. If you take our neighbors, immediate neighbors, they share our education system, they share our health system, they rely on our social security system. And in that sense, although we have borders and maybe visa requirements for most, but not all, we are still, Johannesburg would probably be the most cosmopolitan city on the continent.
Absolutely.
If you look at our academic institutions, you'll see colleagues from all parts of Africa who are professors, lecturers. You'll see doctors who are doing that, lawyers, people in the financial sector. And I think, you know, a borderless Africa doesn't solve all of our problems. It does create better mobility, which is important for economic development. But it's the tougher challenges that we need to take on, which is diversifying our economies, understanding what the theme of this week of the African Development Bank is, structural transformation. And how are we going to, what tools do we have to actually undertake that kind of transformation? And of course, the people factor is a very important one in that.
President Kaburuka.
You know, as a host, I would like to listen to my guests. But at the annual meeting of the bank in Uganda, I recall President Museveni saying, in some African countries, when you enter the border, they ask you, how much money do you have? That is fair enough. The next question is, do you have relatives here? And he did ask, do I need relatives to go to any particular country if I have my own money? They will ask you, what are you coming to do here? But if I have my money, why do you ask me what I come to do? We still have issues in that particular domain, as Mr. President here is saying. But look at Dubai. I think one of the most successful countries in the region. 90% of the population and above are foreigners. And as Mr. President says, the security, immigration, people can deal with them. But because of this fairly radical way to look at economic development, they open the borders and Dubai is thriving. Some of their neighbors who are more closed are doing less work. So I think, at least from where I sit at the bank, I don't think Africa has a choice. This thing can be delayed. But if we are gonna take advantage of the full weight of Africa's potential, at some point, we'll have to get people, mechanized skills moving across the borders. Otherwise, we shall be changing Africa very short. So we can delay it, but I don't think we can stop it, number one. Number two, it will happen because we have no choice. Look at the situation in the global economy today. Europe, which dominated the world from what, 1500? I saw an Economist magazine yesterday saying, well, the Eurozone is an accident waiting to happen. I hope they're wrong. The global economy is slowing down. Where will growth come from? Growth will come from here in Africa, but it won't come if we still have our 54 passports, 54 borders, 25 currency regimes, at some point economic logic will have to come in and we let the African people prosper. And that's why we at the bank emphasize very much economic integration. It's 20% of all our operations in every single region of Africa. We are doing things which enable people and mechanisms to move. But on some borders where the bank has built roads, at least I saw one in East Africa, Mr. President, we spent about $150 million doing this highway. And when I went to the border, I found that trucks were stuck there for 2 days. Now, we can build roads, but until people are allowed to move, because roads are means to an end, nothing will happen. I don't think we have a choice.
President Kaburuka, thank you very much for making that point. And it draws me to push this conversation on to the bigger issue of leadership. Because ultimately, that is what I believe this boils down to. And I'll pass this on to Mo Ibrahim, because you've put your money where your mouth is, as I said, and you have a foundation that is supporting and looking for transformational leadership in Africa. You've attended many AU meetings, I'm sure, in your time, and many conferences. Do you get the sense that the transformational leadership is there, that the continent is moving at the pace it needs to in terms of leadership to achieve the goals that everyone on this panel desires?
Can I be frank? And
please.
Donald, you will not banish me for any meeting in the future. Can I be frank?
I'm sorry?
Can I be frank and you will not kick me out of your meetings?
No. Nobody can kick me out.
Okay. To be honest, I really believe we have a serious leadership deficit in Africa. Really, look around you. So how many African leaders are out there really fighting Africa corners, taking the issues beyond their little daily sort of issues there to really, how many of our leaders, we have 54 leaders or presidents in Africa, how many of them will not be more than you can count on one hand, who are really standing up and fighting Africa corners. Look, for this integration to happen, we need to take this case to the people. We need really to go and explain to our people why we want it. This needs leadership to tell people, look, this is in our interest. Our GDP actually is so funny. You speak to people in East Africa, they say, those guys are going to come from South Africa and take our businesses and take our jobs, and we're going to lose. You go to South Africa and say, we have 5 million people here. We're going to have some more people coming and you know, take the, so let us put some, you know, tires around their necks, or, you know, drag them behind police cars or whatever they do to them. And you say, excuse me, this cannot be true. This cannot be true. And we are really going to all benefit from this. It needs guts, it needs leaders to stand up to all this mess and say, no, this is the future for us guys to go forward. 54 little countries like that have no future. I think actually half of African countries are not really viable. When you look at the numbers, and everybody in this panel knows that, but because of their position, they will not say it. We walk out there in the VIP room, they will say, yes, Mo, you're right. Donald, I mean, I'm not putting you on the spot.
Mo, you're right.
Here.
He's saying it in the room.
God bless the ANC. But really, we need to be open and honest about this. We need to go out there, our media, our people. Where is people like, we don't have a Kwame Nkrumah now. We don't have Nyerere now. We don't have Madiba now. We don't have, where are those big beasts who will stand there and fight the corner for Africa and lay down the law? We don't have.
It's a question for President Kagame. Is there an African champion, or are there African champions of the ilk that Mo Ibrahim speaks of? Are there, if I could ask it differently, are there leaders that you look up to?
I think there should be leaders like Mo is saying. That's what I can say. There should be. And if indeed we need to transform our continent and realize the benefits for our people, again, we have no alternative. Much as we struggle on a daily basis with that leadership deficit which has been talked about, it is there also. But
so you agree there is a leadership deficit
there
on
is,
the continent?
There is, because that's why first of all, that's why what we have been saying defeats the logic. We have all the resources on one hand. We understand the problem. We've talked about how to deal with it, but it doesn't happen. Or it doesn't happen as fast as it should be happening. So it means there's something, because things won't happen until people do what they need to do.
So President Kagame, if I may ask, do you ever tire of attending African Union summits?
Well, I attend all of them.
I know.
And I won't say I ever get tired of them, but...
Let me ask you different. Do you sense the frustration that many people have when they hear there's another AU summit, there's another conference on, you know, capacity
building? Well, I think more of our citizens, I think, are the ones who are frustrated more than we, the leaders, which in itself is not a good story. And if we, the leaders, got tired of, you know, looking at this frustration of our citizens, then we need to be doing better. And I think we've been very slow at that. I mean, that is a fact. And that is also the challenge we need to address. We have to make sure that, again, many things have been said before, we can't afford to keep doing things the business as usual way. We need to find some way that expresses or that is commensurate to the level of urgency that we need to put into what we are doing.
Pravin Gordhan.
Yeah, I want to, in the spirit of openness, contest Mo's approach to leadership. I don't think we can repeatedly have an Nkrumah or a Madiba or a Nyerere, but I think what we do have is 100 people on the African continent from the political fraternity, the business fraternity, civil society fraternity, who could constitute a very effective collective leadership if they overcome some of the things that the president is talking about, which is switch on a sense of urgency about what we want to do, begin to focus on action and delivery rather than talking, begin to put on the ground actual projects which have a demonstration effect that we can deliver on the words and the rhetoric that we actually engage in. And I think we are doing that in different parts of the continent. Donald will have a good perspective on that. And in that sense, leadership doesn't mean a persona necessarily. It also means a state of mind. It means an ability to actually envision a different future, which we are envisioning on the African continent. It means having the determination to fight against these odds, which are real, you can't deny them. But the issue is not to wallow in them, but to say, I'll overcome them. And that's the spirit that actually needs to pervade not just leaders who attend the African Union, but also leaders who attend the ADB annual meetings as well. And if we can pervade ourselves with that kind of spirit, I think in the next 5 years, you could deliver an interesting set of propositions which are concrete, which are real, and which are demonstrative of the fact that we can do things differently.
But Donald Kaburuga, isn't Mo's point, Mo Ibrahim's point, that we know what to do, we talk about what to do, but there's a disconnect between that and what actually happens at the level of leadership? You recently wrote a fairly critical piece post-African Union meeting, the last, the 50th anniversary. And I wonder if you share that argument, that there is a bit of a disconnect between what is being said at the political level and what is being done.
Well, I don't agree with Mo very often, but on this one, I think I can agree with you. I think there is a famous scientist who said that...
I'm looking for some friends on this panel.
I'm your friend.
You are my friend. The scientist said that there's a definition, a technical definition of madness, which is doing the same thing all over again and expecting a different outcome.
Einstein,
thank you. Sometimes one has that feeling that we're repeating the same things, hoping something different will come out. However, in all fairness, let us not condemn everything happening on the African continent. Things are moving, especially because of the young, these demographic pressures. I think this continent has achieved much more than the colonial powers over a century of occupation of this continent. I think South Africa, you mentioned, has achieved much more than the apartheid regime. My own country, under leadership, Mr. President, has achieved much more than all the past colonial powers together. So we have, at this time of the 50th anniversary, things for which we can be very proud, and things for which we have to correct, because that is our responsibilities. Now, I didn't write a critical piece, Tomla. I simply said there are big mega trends in the world there in the next 50 years, which is leadership. All of us in business, institutions like this, have to be aware of and deal with them. And one of them, I pointed out, was that almost every single African country today is discovering something. Oil, gas, base metals, or something. Every single country. We have a chance in a generation because of this commodity super cycle. We can use these resources to build infrastructure, which everybody mentions, to train the people. This is what will transform the continent. But what are we doing? Some countries are busy signing lopsided contracts with the complex ownership models, with transfer pricing, benefiting foreign companies, taking Africa's wealth abroad instead of keeping here. Now, in some cases, that is being done with the complicity of the government. In other cases, it is companies exploiting the weaknesses of the institutions and governments. What I said in this piece was, this matter has to be resolved, because the future generations, frankly, cannot forgive us for dilapidating Africa's wealth in this way.
President Kagame, I think it moves our conversation on. I think that does deserve a round of applause. It moves our conversation on to our relations with the rest of the world. It is a very interesting time in the continent's political history, in its international affairs, where we are, in some ways, caught between competing interests yet again. This time, the emergence of China, President Obama's coming to, is visiting Africa again after a fairly long period away next month. I wonder if you, as a head of state, and seeing the kind of economic transformation that Rwanda has achieved, whether this has translated into a greater political influence on the world stage.
Well, let me build the answer on what was being discussed for what it may be worth. First, it is true, and there are grounds for people to have a sense of optimism. But I want to caution that we need not celebrate this sense of optimism. Instead, we need to be aware of the burden that comes with it, which is to double or even triple our effort in trying to resolve the problems we are faced with. And this is really where the burden and even the definition of leadership actually comes about. How do leaders translate this to real tangible results that affect our people? And just as Don has, Dr. Kaberuka has just concluded about resources and how they are being exploited by others other than the owners, the Africans.
But with the complicity of...
Precisely, that's the point I'm trying to arrive at. There is that complicity of leaders. Now, in this day and age, when we were talking about this being Africa's hour, and the whole history as we know it, and all these problems as we have articulated them and discussed them, and even made recommendations how we deal with these issues, to be talking about this today shows how much there is that disconnect that was being talked about. Now, we go to the next point which you've just raised. You see, how Africa and how all of us relate with the rest of the world, simply will mirror what is happening that we are talking about. If you are a continent, a country on this continent that is being exploited in this way, then you expect that everything else will follow that model. Isn't it? So Rwanda or Africa or other countries, I think we need to look at indeed different models that specifically deal with our challenges. And anything we will do, whether you're talking about leadership, or you're talking about governance, or you're talking about different processes, it's about delivery. It's about results. Anything else is a waste of time. You always measure leadership, implementation, delivery on the results. You can have very nice stories about different things. As long as there are no results to show for that, it has been a waste of time. So, yes, China is around. It offers an alternative to many things we have come to be used to that have not delivered much for us. But again, if you see what happens out there, China and the developed countries, they are at each other's throat over Africa. So Africa is in between as a victim. So and that's why one side asks the other, what are you doing in Africa? The other one says, no, I'm not doing anything wrong. What are you doing there? And for us, we are just waiting to be exploited. How can Africa remain in this state, and for how long? So this is what compels. Really, there is a sense of urgency in this. Africans working together, this integration we are talking about, we already have reports and files on the shelf about what our problems are, about what needs to be done, and by who, and how. We know that. So, but when do we get these volumes off the shelf and implement what needs to be implemented?
Mo Ibrahim. I want to put that China question to you. In fact, it's a question that can apply to all of our quote-unquote international partners. It is clear that China has a very determined and clear interest in Africa. Their diplomatic offensive is not by accident. They know exactly what they want, and they know exactly how they're going to do it. Your background is in business. A business plan is the most basic thing you should have. Do you get the sense that across the continent, as you travel around and you engage with leaders, that there is a very clear plan for dealing with China?
Not none whatsoever. Look, like anything in the world, this is a balance of power. China is a giant over there. When it deals with 54 African countries, what is the balance of power between a country like China and a small country in Africa of 4 or 5 million people with a GDP which is less than 1% of the GDP of China? What is the balance of power there? How this president sit with that president and talk? You see, because we don't have a collective view. If China, with 50 provinces, each one with its own customs, with its own, you know, that would have been a completely different story. So we cannot, look, in this world, nobody's trying to do a favor to anybody. This world is run not by charity or by good heart. It is a jungle. It is a jungle, you know? The elephant walks first, and the guys run around from here, then the lion come. And then we have the little lambs in Africa, you know, just trying to find the little rabbits some place in this jungle. And that is the world is like that. This is the truth. And as long as we are small, little economies, we have no voice. We cannot go to the WTO and bang the table and say, we don't have a place at the table. So we don't have that leverage over China, because China's not in love with us. China is in love with its own people, and rightly so. So don't expect a favor from anybody. China is in Africa for its own interest, and rightly so. America or Europe in Africa for its own interest, its own people interest, not for our own interest. The question for us now, what are we doing about our own interest? And this comes to the point which the president here raised. Where is our collective will or plan or what we want to do? And that really imbalance between relationship between our trading partners is not in favor of our country. Then, of course, we have, as what Donald politely referred to, the actual theft of our resources, either because we are stupid and we sign off contracts really, or because we are criminals and we take some bribe and give our resources away. I just talked about the other day about the case of Guinea, how that great resource of iron ore was given to an Israeli company for $130 million, only for them to sell half of it to Vale, the Brazilian company, for $2.5 billion. So here is an asset of $5 billion. And some dictator, dying dictator in Guinea, give it for $130 million. And then you say, these guys are criminal? Of course they are criminal. But also they are stupid. Because if you are a smart criminal, you have an asset worth $5 billion. Well, sell it for $4 billion. Okay? You don't sell it for $130 million. I mean, those guys are stupid also. You are daft. And
Pravin Gordhan, I mean, China is South Africa's China's biggest partner. What is South Africa's strategy for dealing with the Chinese?
You know, a concrete example would be trade between South Africa and China. I think it's about a year and a half or two ago where our government indicated to the Chinese government that our trade relationship, albeit that it is growing at the rate it is growing, can't be merely about exporting minerals from South Africa to China and importing manufactured goods from China into South Africa, which is the African story at the end of the day. And what we want is a basket of goods which are made in South Africa and have a made in South Africa label, so to speak, which the Chinese markets must absorb in reciprocation in some ways. And I think the real question is, on the one hand, you know, there might be criminals and so on, but it's a business person talking about five versus four versus $130 million. How do we get leverage? That's the question. Everybody will have their self-interest. That's the reality of the situation in which we live in. Now, we either sit and moan about it, or we begin to change the discourse, we begin to develop models which say this is how we can actually get leverage. We start making a lot more public noise, both as politicians and as civil society and as business, about how we want resources to stay in Africa for Africa's development, and begin to develop the negotiating power to be able to do so. Now, one of the ironies of the world today, if I follow on Donald's comments, is that it's the G7 which says tax-based erosion and profit shifting is a problem today, having done that by their companies over decades in respect of the African continent. So welcome to the club, because now we are living in an environment where there's very little fiscal space. You need to increase your revenue base. And it's fascinating to see the G7 saying to their multinational companies, pay more tax in our environment. Mm. For the CEO of Apple, for example, and I'm sure there's many iPhones, I have one in my pocket as well, let me confess, that are in this audience. But for the CEO of Apple to sit before the US Senate in the world and say, I pay every cent that I owe, but pay 2% tax in Ireland, can't be right. Can't be right in a world in which, on the one hand, there's the fiscal and economic crisis, and on the other hand, governments are looking for resources to deliver services to their citizens. And if we can speak with one voice on some of these issues, and I believe that the African Development Bank provides us with the forum, which is our own, where we can raise our voices, where we can create our own formulae, like I said earlier on, and raise these sorts of questions first amongst ourselves, and develop the strength to bargain with everybody else, then we'll begin to get somewhere. But we can't sit and moan about these things.
Is the BRICS the alternative as well?
The BRICS gives you some leverage. The BRICS begins to give you some leverage. It creates a diversity in the power correlations in the world. It provides a new set of opportunities to undertake trade and investment. And the numbers you can see are already changing. Although Africa's exports to Europe is still at about 30-34%, BRICS has risen to 24% overall, and the US has fallen to 17%. So trade relationships are changing. 50% of global trade today is south-south trade, no longer north-south trade or north-north trade. So those dynamics are changing as well. And so these mega trends that Donald refers to are ones that we need to understand better, but more importantly, begin to develop some cohesion around. And I think there are fascinating prospects to get a better deal for Africa at the end of the day.
Donald Kaburuka.
You know, Kumbla, it's plain vanilla. Nations have interests, they don't have friends. We have always known this. So I've never understood the obsession with China. China is defending Chinese interests, period. As Europeans have done, North Americans have done, so it's up to Africans to defend African interests. Now, if we don't defend African interests, who is to blame? You can't blame the foreigners. Now, this applies to natural resources as to anything else. But I think, though, this obsession with China also leads me to conclude, like Praveen, that maybe what we need to do as African leaders is to sit back and say, okay, so there is this reshaping of the global economic power. Global economic power has shifted from the north to everywhere. It's in the Gulf, it's in China, it's in Brazil, it's in Turkey. And then we decide, how do we want to relate to this new global reality, maximizing our own advantage? And I think as long as we can do that and agree to defend our own interests, I think we can relate to anybody, traditional partners, new partners, partners to come, why not? And I think, as Praveen says, we have the capacity in the bank to help any country, any government, willing to ensure they have balanced contracts, balanced relationships, but that presumes that we are asked to, because we cannot go to replace ourselves for the national authorities. There are a couple of governments who have asked us to take a second look at the kind of this relationship they're having. Sometimes we have done this and there's no follow-up, but we're determined to keep doing more of this because we think it is a fundamental issue for this continent for many, many years to come.
Excuse me, there's something. Please, President.
Let me add something little we shouldn't miss here. Contracts, Africa Development Bank, very helpful, and countries should really seek their indulgence. But then China, the West economies, what do all of these have to do with us doing so little with each other, intra-African?
Which is sclerotic right now.
Yeah. Which is very minuscule. Why don't we first answer this? We Africans, why do we do less and less with each other and start complaining, or people looking at us and complaining about how much the others are doing with us? So I think we need to address this problem. Africa investing in Africa.
But Mr. President, you have the ear of your fellow heads of state. And there is no doubt that they respect what you say.
Well, I'm speaking to you now. The heads of state are not around. But as we said earlier, I think there was a mention of the private sector, the civil society groups. I think we even pressures need to come from all corners. Yes, in order for some people to start thinking right and doing the right thing.
Mr. President, we were going to enter the final round of comments from all of the panelists tonight, and when you said about thinking right, I'm going to start the final round of questions with something that you've said repeatedly, and I believe you said just the other day, that there needs to be a point of realization that the rest of the world does not owe Africa anything. I want you to speak to that and talk about the importance of not just this economic transformation and infrastructural transformation that we've been talking about, obviously here at the AFDB meetings, but the psychological transformation, not just of leadership, but of young people across the continent. Are we training the next generation of leaders and professionals and financiers and experts who have the right kind of psychological approach to transforming this continent?
There has to be change of mindset, no question about it. We've seen in the past, young and old, people in Africa, I will say what I know was happening even in my own country specifically, where people would just sit back and wait for things to be delivered to them or done for them. And what we've been struggling with over time is to try and tell our people, see, nobody owes you a thing. You are a farmer, go to your farm and grow your crops, and you must be wanting to feed yourself, your family, and take what you can take to the market. That's it. It's about governance. We tell our people, when we are talking about corruption, for example, and I have seen this trend, we don't have to mention places, but I'm just using my own country as an example, where you would find a mentality that, and see that it's like people are fighting corruption because somebody is demanding it from outside, and say, well, if we, you know, if there is corruption, we want to give you this, we want to give. Why should anybody be reacting in terms of fighting corruption because somebody else is demanding it, when there is realization that corruption is something that will just be a spoiler in everything you are doing, whether it is politics, whether it is the economy, or whatever. So the mentality that we are the ones to do it, we must own it. Now, support, absolutely. You need support, you can have support, but it is about putting you on your feet to stand on your own. It's not about being dependent. It's about realization of people's aspirations, where they can be the ones to define their destiny. But this relationship globally, where some parts of the world people who decide what others in other parts of the world will do or not do, is simply not sustainable. And of course, it is contributed to by people not taking full responsibility for themselves and doing what is right, because they think it is right and they understand the importance of that, not because they are being told and whipped and kicked to do what is right.
Mo Ibrahim.
What's my question, please?
Your final thoughts.
Yeah. I just want to say something with no touch much about it. We're all campaigning for better governance in Africa, and we define governance as deliverable. What at the end people deliver to their people? And that's why we do the index to try to measure that deliverance, et cetera. But the one area which I think needs some attention from civil society and from governments, of course, is that of governance of the private sector. We cannot have just good governance in the public sector and terrible governance in the private sector. And that's a big issue. If you look at the illicit transfer of funds out of Africa, it is more than double the amount of aid Africa is receiving. It's a huge sum of money leaving Africa because people don't pay their taxes. Simple like that, because transfer prices, all these so-called, which fortunately is a big issue in the West now, and actually I've just received the, it's going to be a big issue in 2 weeks in the big meeting in London, and actually for my, I thought you asked me to go and speak about it, for the, but it's a good opportunity for us to go and fight that issue. This is a very important issue for us. Governance in the private sector. Governance private sector not only in mispricing and illicit transfer of funds, which is huge, but also on bribery and corruption. Because when people attack African leaders or policymakers and say, oh, you guys have many corrupt people there, I always say, look, you know what? For every corrupt African official, there at least 24 corrupt Western business people, and Chinese now, of course. Who is talking about those guys? Okay? Because it is a crime committed by all these consenting adults. And so we need to turn the light on that, and it's time to raise the issue of governance in the private sector. I think that's something African leaders should really raise and focus on it. We're losing so much because of the really mismanagement. Actually, they almost brought the system down in the financial sector by all this nonsense they were doing over there. That's a very important issue. And it's interesting because the political moment is right. Mm. And I was so delighted when the American passed the law about the Dodd-Frank, about disclosure of contracts country by country. Europe passed a similar law. Actually, I heard now Europe is rushing a law to force really declaration of incomes, profits, etc., for any company, not just resource companies, on country by country basis.
Yes.
That's something we need, so we can get those guys to pay their taxes where they really belong. And these are important developments happening around us because of the financial problems over there. It's our moment to catch this and to go now and really force that issue. We have a lot to gain out of this. So I hope our leaders are really aware of this change, sea changes happening around us. Let us make use of it and push our case forward.
Pravin Gordhan, before we came here, we were chatting in the back room, and you wanted to emphasize that this whole question of is this Africa's hour needs to be reframed in the context that this is not, it's not the hour, it's more the journey, it's more the process. As you look forward, I just wonder if you can distill your thoughts into a big picture statement. 5 years from now, if we are blessed to be here and we're having this conversation, what should the past 5 years have brought? Where should we be looking to the future?
I suppose, firstly, everything we are talking about must make a difference in the lives, concretely, of a billion people on the continent. Because the true test is not how many kilometers of roads we build or how many dams we build, but whether people can say that we've impacted on their lives in a positive way. There's better education, there's better health, there's better living conditions, and there's better working cities and rural areas in the continent. So the true measure is the well-being of a billion people and how we impact upon them. Secondly, the opportunity we have, as I said earlier on, is to create a socially just economic system, one that doesn't replicate inequality, one that doesn't encourage more corruption, in fact, discourages corruption, one that gets elites on the continent to pay their taxes, because that's how governments can effectively do their work. Because if those taxes are hidden in one or other haven of one kind or another, we're then speaking with forked tongues. On the one hand, we want development. On the other hand, we don't want to put our own money, as you said about Ibrahim, where our mouths are. Mm. So we have an opportunity to create a better ethical environment, create a truly socially just system, and one that does create jobs for the many young people on this continent that don't have jobs. But finally, for all of this to be sustainable, we need both that human capital we were referring to earlier on, but institutions that are resilient and that can work. Because it's institutions that will continue after all of us are gone. It's institutions that can sustain the kind of ideas and work that we're actually talking about. Our job as this generation is to put those institutions in place and make sure that there are enough leaders around to sustain this effort over a 30-year period, because that's how long it's going to take us for our hour to become a proper day.
Donald Kaburuka, you have the final word. Is this Africa's hour?
No, the final word is for my president and yourself. So, but let me say the following. Those of you who are here at lunchtime for the financial presentation of the outcome of the bank's operations had reference to something we are calling Africa 50 Fund. That is an initiative we are launching here at the bank, basically to say, after 50 years, how does Africa finance its own development? It cannot be that a child born at independence is now 50, still wants to get assisted by the parents, or worse still by someone else. So I hope this initiative takes off, because for me, that will be truly the single signal that we are finally getting to assuming responsibility for our own development. It's an initiative which does not say anybody should give us grants. We're saying we're giving a vehicle for how everybody can invest in this tool. We can finance all these PIDA projects, infrastructure, CADEP, the kind of things we have been talking about for the last few weeks and months. Number two, the debate at this meeting in Marrakesh is about growth and transformation. Because you have been asking whether Africa has been growing. Of course it is. The numbers are there. Has Africa been transforming much more slowly? More in your absence, I refer to what you said to me at the WEF in Cape Town. I said rather stupidly that now we have more phones than anyone else in the world. And you said to me, but how many of the components of those phones does Africa manufacture? It is a reality. So the debate we're having this week is fundamental for Africa's future. What is our plan? What is our vision? How do we finance it? Finally, a small point, Komla, since you have been so gracious to be moderating this debate. I think that the changes taking place in the world at the moment are some of the things which happen once in a generation. And I want to come back to these natural resources. Forgive me for repeating it. Because these super cycles in commodities happen sometimes twice a century. It has happened twice in this century. Now, commodity markets might remain very strong, but they will level off at some point. That is why it is important to ensure that we take advantage of what we have now, these young, urban people, the natural resources, ability to leapfrog technology like we have done in mobile phones, to ensure that we don't meet many of us won't be here in 50 years to say the same things. And we will play our part at the African Development Bank. We are launching a new strategy for 10 years, which we call a strategy for economic transformation, growth and inclusion, which I'll be discussing tomorrow. And I hope at the end of the day, we make a difference in the lives of the African people. So thank you very much, Komla.
Thank you very much. President Kagame, as the one of the most internet and technologically savvy heads of state we have on the continent, we need a Twitter moment from you now.
I use more than 140 characters in this one. Optimism for Africa, yes, there is a solid ground for that. Second, however, this means more work, not less. We need to continue to invest in our people, in establishing institutions that within which these people will serve and will be served. We need to invest, continue investing in our women, our youth, and give them the cause to believe that this continent is theirs and that it can be built on their strength as citizens of this country, and really demographics show that they are a force that we can't ignore, but also educate them and work with them to make sure that ideologically, they also understand what is at stake for them and for everybody else on our continent.
President Kagame, thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, join me in saying thank you to Mo Ibrahim, to Pravin Gordhan, to President Kagame, and to our kind host here at the AFDB, Donald Kaberuka. Gentlemen, thank you so much. It's been an excellent conversation. I'd also like to thank all of you who've attended, and a special thank you to, they don't often get much mention, but the ladies and gentlemen in the back providing the translation, thank you as well. Ladies and gentlemen, have a good evening. There we go. I enjoyed myself thoroughly. Yes. Good to see you.